It must be a very good morning for you out there, and it is one indeed for us at Urban TV. Thank you for keeping it urban. Welcome to The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Now, globally, governments are adjusting their tax policies to help address the effects of COVID-19. The adjustments are focused on supporting businesses to weather economic disruptions. To discuss the progress in Uganda is the Uganda Revenue Authority's supervisor, tariffs in the Customs Department, Jude Ocheng. Jude, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Nicholas, and good morning, viewers.
Jude, COVID-19 has disrupted every other aspect of our lives. How has it been like at URA?
Nicholas, I want to tell you and our viewers that COVID-19 really affected our business operations. And one, there was a problem of mobility of goods. There was a problem of businesses closing. And as such, government came up with some initiatives to keep businesses afloat, and that's what I'll be sharing with you today. For example, to keep businesses afloat, government extended filing dates. You know, statutorily, you're required to file your taxes by the 15th day of June, but the government extended those dates to 30th of June each financial year. This financial year to file returns. And these are returns that related to payee. We know payee is what we pay when we earn a salary, VAT, which is basically a consumption tax, as well as other taxes, income taxes, such as withholding tax. Also, government waived off the penalties on taxes that may accrue because of the challenges that that came up because of COVID-19. So penalties, all penalties that would accrue because of late filing were waived off. Government also has provided many avenues through which you could pay your taxes. One of such avenues was you could use our online banking systems such as EFTs and RTGS systems. You could use our agency bankings. Then Visa, we are using also Visa cards and MasterCards, specifically in Stanbic Bank, Absa, Orient Bank. Mobile money for small taxes, you could use mobile money, and you could, as well as the many payway services that we have on the market.
So are there any specific administrative initiatives that URA is putting in place to ensure that they boost businesses in this economic slowdown?
Yes, the number I'll talk about few. One is that because we know that cash flow has been strapped or has been there's no cash flow coming in, they've provided for installment payments, meaning you can pay your tax obligations, you can ask to restructure your payments over an extended period of time, and that way your incomes may not take a big beating. Also, we have deferred payments where you ask for relief a period of time, maybe 3 or 4 months, and then you resume the payments after a certain period of time. We believe this will help to keep people's capital such that when they return into business, they can reinvest this money before paying the tax and their businesses can grow.
Maybe when you talk about deferring payments, are all taxes, are all of them subject to deferment, or there are specific taxes that are subject to deferment?
Subject to deferment basically applies to local taxes, such as your VATs, such as your income taxes. However, these facilities also only applicable to compliant taxpayers. Those who have a history with us, that they have been paying in time, filing in time, and now because of this pandemic, they are not able to do so. They can write to the Commissioner of Domestic Taxes and ask for a period of which taxes may not be paid, but those taxes shall accrue at a much later date. And this also will not attract any penalties or interests.
But you talked of deferring pay as you earn, and I think local service tax. But I would tell you that most workers, despite shouldering pay cuts, continue to pay high taxes in pay as you earn and local service tax. What is causing this?
Pay as you earn is a tax that increases as your incomes increase. Ideally, if you're in the lower income brackets, you actually pay very little or don't pay any pay as you earn. For example, the threshold is 235,000. Anyone earning less than 235,000 does not shoulder. But in principle, government still needs these revenues to provide the services. So yes, it is incremental, but at the lower level, the pay as you earn taxes you pay are not that much, it can be shouldered.
So when you say, well, you said in most cases it can be shouldered, but initially you had talked of government, one of the tax measures that it put in place was deferring pay as you earn for sectors that have been affected. And I am asking, why is it that some of the workers in these sectors continue to shoulder high taxes in pay as you earn, yet there's that tax break?
The tax break provided is provided for the companies. Mm. If you notice that the company is the one that pays for you the tax in principle. So what happens is that when the company does not pay that tax, say for a period of 2 or 3 months, it can retain this money and reinvest this money. Mind you, this is a deferred payment. It's not a payment that is exempt. So let's assume just in principle that I earn 5 million shillings and my pay as you earn is 2 million shillings. The 2 million shillings is still payable, but this provision is that it helps the business retain this money as working capital for a period in time T, reinvest this money such that it can continue employing you. So the benefit extends to your employer, and how it benefits you, the employee, is that then the company can keep you working because they can use this money to generate or grow the business, and then they'll pay it to you a later. So that is where you take the benefit as the worker.
You raise a very important point that companies will have to pay this money at a much later date. But you are aware that tax compliance in this country is a bit of an issue. Are you sure, as you are, you will be able to follow up on these companies so that they are able to pay up the taxes that were deferred?
One is that government is cognizant of the fact that compliance is important, and that is why these deferred payments were extended to companies that have a history of compliance. That is the first principle. But also, the law gives government a mandate and legal instruments of which to follow taxes in case they are not paid. So that is not our biggest worry right now. The biggest worry, or the biggest worry of government, is that it needs businesses to continue. So we shall not allow the few instances where there is a problem collecting those taxes stop us from saving the many companies that we know are compliant and continue to pay us taxes. Just for your information, 95% of all our taxes comes through what is called the normal flow, compliant people who pay without being put under distress. I think that number is quite a good statistics. We would like this to be 100, but it's not yet there. But the 5% bad apples cannot spoil the party for the 95%.
Jude, government drafted new taxes relating to international trade. What is the purpose of these amendments, and what are they exactly, if I deal in international trade, and I would like to hear from you?
This financial year and a few financial years before that, government has taken a very aggressive policy towards growing local industry in principle. I think we have all heard about Bubu Buy Uganda, Build Uganda, this initiative. So as such, government has been developing policy that will encourage local production and discourage importation. Basically, what you call import substitution. So a number of areas have been identified, and most of these areas are for consumer goods that are easy to produce, such as toothpaste, such as juices, such as the toilet papers. These areas, government increased the duties. When you increase duty, you make it expensive to import, and you provide an incentive for those industries that are already established locally to, one, get bigger market share, or it also encourages new industries to come into the country and invest because they see a very big market. Uganda alone is a market of about 40 million people, I can say that. Then East Africa is a market of over 170 million people. If you notice, we belong to the East African community. When you produce goods in Uganda, you're not just targeting the Uganda. Because we are a community, you can export these goods to Tanzania, to Kenya, Rwanda, Burundi, and taxes shall not be paid in those countries. So that is a serious incentive. But that is not the only market. We are also a member of a bigger community called COMESA. We have neighbors to the west. That is DRC is a big market that we are encouraging Ugandans to invest and tap into that market. We have the South Sudan market, it's a very big market. So the policy of government is to encourage local manufacturing. And this is done by, one, increasing the import duty of finished goods, a number of them, that are available or are easy to make in the region, but also by reducing taxes on raw materials. We have a scheme called duty remission. In that scheme, this scheme is such that raw materials attract lower taxes. I'll just give one example, which is very vivid, that the raw material for making paint is imported at zero import duty.
Oh.
Now, the imported paint attracts a rate of 35%, a rate higher. Now, if you notice that most of us here will use local paint, the same policy applies to, say, tissue paper. Most of the tissue paper, serviettes, toilet paper, is the import duty rate is 60%, but the raw material attract is just 10%. So this encourages people to produce locally.
Actually, that is where the worry was, that when you talk about amendments or adjustments in taxes on imported goods, how about raw materials? Because we have manufacturers here that basically depend on imported raw materials. How are you handling that as URA?
As URA, raw materials, a whole host of raw materials are coming in at no import duty. Let me give you an example. Textiles. For people who are making garments, they are importing raw materials at no import duty. They don't pay import duty, but the imported textiles are quite charged expensively. So that's an incentive. It means that if I want to make a garment, like make shirts, I can import these raw materials, the yarn, and make the shirts here locally. Leather products for making shoes, the import duties have been reduced to 0%. So if you're starting a cottage industry, you want to produce shoes, the incentive to produce here is very, very high at the moment. And we have a whole lot of raw materials that are coming in at 0% and a few at 10%. So that is where government is driving. But the finished products are a little bit expensive.
But maybe for clarity, when you talked about, is there a certain category within which you zone imported products from within common markets, say, and communities, say, East African community or the COMESA, vis-a-vis products that come from elsewhere?
Yes, the finished goods that come from the community, the East African community, don't attract duty. In principle, that is it plays back the other way. Mm. That also when we export to our community members, they also don't attract duty on these items. And this extends to a number of goods. That's why you see our shelves are full of products that are made in East Africa, Uganda and the rest. And when you actually do travel to the other countries, it is the same. They give us the same treatment. you notice, for example, our tiles here are having a lot of market in Kenya, and also some Kenyan products are having market here. So we are hoping to grow as a community, because this market is a fairer market when it is big. The 170 million I was talking about is the market you're really targeting. But we are a bit discriminatory on the same goods when they are coming from outside that community.
But so you talk of amendments in taxes on international trade or finished products, imported finished products. How about, are there any amendments on customs taxes to support local businesses?
The amendments on local taxes, yes, we do have. I'll just highlight a few products whereby import duties rates have been increased from 25% to 60%, and this is purely to support local business. One of those areas is beverages. This, what we drink every day, the juices, the sodas, the Red Bulls, those, the import duty rate has been increased. 25% to 60% is quite a huge jump. Then we have products such as honey. You'll not believe how much honey, I believe, for health reasons, a number of us take honey. But when you go to our shelves, we are having a lot of honey from Asian countries. But you know that some regions of Uganda actually produce a lot of honey, like West Nile region. So the question is, should we encourage the people from these regions to improve packaging? Because their honey is actually many times more superior. So we are discouraging importation of such products. Another such product is processed coffee or processed tea. Uganda is one of the very few lucky countries that we produce more tea than we consume and produce more coffee than we consume. You can't believe that. So, but our shelves are full of processed coffee. I think the president always mentions this, that we produce, we export, it is processed, and we bring it back. Now, government is thinking that going forward, if we produce, let's process it here. So it means that if you're to take out, it's okay to take out, but if you bring it back processed, the import duty rate will be very high. So more companies are going to actually start processing locally, at least for our market and the regional market. Another such product is cooking oil, sunflower oil, cottonseed oil. We produce a number of these locally, and we have been importing it at a low rate before, but now the rates have been increased. It is to discourage importation. Chicken. If you notice, in every backyard, there's a poultry farm right now. Why? Because of this incentive that now more farmers are starting to see the benefits of being protected. So those are a few categories of such goods.
So Jude, in all this, who is the targeted beneficiary?
Our targeted beneficiary, one would be, it would be our manufacturers. That our manufacturers, or people who intend to go into manufacturing, will take this benefit. The other would be the people who supply those manufacturers. We are a blessed country, so as such, farming is our backbone, and we are encouraging agro-processing industries. So they will have market. Their produce can feed into agro-processing industries. Then ask the local people that if you produce locally, ideally in the long run, our costs should reduce of those items. When our costs reduce, this translates to price. So hopefully in the short term or short to medium term, consumers should benefit from prices dropping on certain consumption or necessary goods that we take.
But all this sounds to cushion the Ugandan business economy from effects of COVID-19. But going to, for example, you highlight farming and agro-processing, what we call as the winners in this COVID-19, for example, the health sector. These are sectors that contribute significantly to GDP but pay very low in taxes. This is something that bothers most Ugandans. How are you preparing to address it as URA post-COVID?
Post-COVID, URA, as a drive, we are really pushing to try to move our tax to GDP ratio higher than it is. I think we are doing 13% to 13.5 now. Mm-hmm. Our target is to reach maybe 18% in the next medium term, 5 years. Mm-hmm. However, agriculture is an area that you have to be cautious when taxing or developing policy for, because it is, let's not tax the source of production itself, because it has a multiplier effect that at the point when we start to produce the finished products, that's where we should be tapping the taxes. So in the short run, taxing agriculture might not be an area we should be very interested in as a country. We should be looking at the products from agriculture in the long run, really, Nicholas.
Jude, we are going for a very short break. When we return, you will tell us how, as an individual, if, for example, I am a salary earn and I earn 1 million shillings and I pay those high taxes in pay as you earn, and yet as a farmer brings in 100 head of cattle untaxed, and what does this exactly mean to the business economy? Stars, yeah.